everyone, dear colleagues. Thank you for the possibility to join the conference and to share with you some ideas. Unfortunately, I didn't have an opportunity to listen to presentations and discussions yesterday. That is why I have lost an opportunity to rethink my own statements, to try to find some emotional links between my presentation and other papers. So, to be honest, I can't say that I feel prepared for 100% for my presentation. And one more thing, please forgive me, I didn't prepare PowerPoint. I know it is cruel, but I will try to do my best and not to read all my paper trying to fit into 20 minutes. So, my presentation will be divided into three parts. First part, short consideration about desovietization processes as attempt to inventorize the past. Second part of presentation, analysis of Lithuanian historiography's transformations as an effort to overcome the empirical approach and to move from totalitarian paradigm to some more sophisticated theoretical background. And last part of my presentation, I hope I will have a few minutes to say something about different drivers of Lithuanian historical culture which interact with the Soviet epoch, trying to play the simultaneous role as Lithuanian historiography do, to provoke, to react, to rethink, to say something meaningful about Soviet epoch, about histories and memories interaction, about our reaction to that past, which is still near. So, one short introductory remark. I'm going to use two terms in my presentation, historiography and historical culture. And historiography I understand as an integral part of historical culture. So in this case, the term of historical culture I would like to use as an umbrella term. Let's start from my first part of my presentation, the desovietization processes as an attempt to inventory the past. We all know that the re-establishment of statehood marked the beginning of a qualitatively new and dynamically changing situation for Lithuanian society, and probably one of the most important tasks for the society, academic community, and new emerging political elite was to create the attitude to the Soviet epoch or to inventory the past. I would like to describe attempts to inventory the past as the effort to answer two closely related questions. First question, what was the Soviet period of Lithuanian history? And second question, what did it mean to be a good Lithuanian citizen during the Soviet occupation? The prevailing answer to the first question, what was the Soviet period of Lithuanian history? The Soviet period was not normal. It was an epoch of disgrace. And unfortunately, I don't have enough time to go into the details, trying to analyze the peculiarities of contemporary Lithuanian society's historical consciousness. That's why I just skipped some part of my presentation, and I just said that statement. But if you would like, after my presentation, I will come back to that statement. So that's why I strongly believe that is why the formula which could be helpful trying to describe Lithuanian Lithuanian society's attitude to the Soviet era is guilt plus disgrace plus sense that is better to forget that than to remember. Now let's come back to the second question. what did it mean to be a good Lithuanian citizen during the Soviet period? I think that the academics, society and representative of political elite proposed three answers to that question during the two decades of the independent state's existence. The first answer, individuals and society's possibilities to choose, slotted in between two oppositions, resistance or collaboration. And the second answer, there were three possible personal or collective decisions in the face of Sovietization processes: resistance, collaboration, or conformance. And the third answer is resistance and collaboration were the destiny of a major group of heroes or scoundrels. Almost all members of Lithuanian society choose the way of conformance. But in this case, it is very important to stress that conformance might not be only the way to recognize the defeat against the Soviet regime, but also the opportunity to survive and to keep the potential of the nation. I think that those three answers, which were described above, can help us to highlight and to analyze the fundamental differences between academic schools, groups of interest within society, and political parties, which are trying to deal with Soviet past or to inventory the Soviet past and to propose one of two strategies of behavior. The representative of the left intellectual and political wing suggests such formula: we were all conformists, and let's start to we were all conformists and patriots of Lithuania at the same time. So let's forget the gray past and let's start to write the nation's history from the new black page. The representative of the right political wing has a completely different point of view. Before forgetting the past, we should identify our heroes and villains to honor the brave sons of the nation and to condemn scoundrels. And in this field of intersection and divide of opinion, liberal wing is trying to take the position of moderator on the one hand, on the other hand, but I can't say that such efforts of liberals to open the window for the discussion, for the dialogue between the left and right, and to moderate that dialogue are successful. I think we should have in mind all three these circumstances by trying to understand Lithuanian historians' communities' efforts to think and to talk about Soviet epoch. And now I'm moving to the second part of my presentation, Lithuanian historiography in front of Soviet epoch challenge. So it is obvious that the first decade of contemporary Lithuanian historiography's development was marked by attempt to find balance between society's demands, politicians' interests, and historians' abilities. I would like to stress that these two words, historians' abilities, to rethink the past and to act in new social, cultural, and socio-political reality. These circumstances, which were mentioned above, created the following peculiarities of the Lithuanian historiography of Soviet period, and I'm going to present five aspects. First aspect, the focus on the geopolitical situation before World War II, and in particular to attempts to rethink the importance of Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact. Second aspect, the exceptional attention to the Lithuanian statehood demolition and Sovietization processes, trying to understand the whole mechanism and its logic of behavior. Third aspect, the efforts to collect and to analyze data about the most traumatic Lithuanian society's experience during the late Stalinism epoch: persecutions, repressions, deportations, and so on. Fourth aspect, the really careful work trying to register all cases of military, civil, and socio-cultural resistance against the Soviet regime. And fifth aspect, the attempts to recreate the guerrilla war history in Soviet Lithuania, trying to reconstruct a general picture of armed resistance and to restore separate details of that picture. I think it is very important to say a few words about guerrilla war, not only as the object of careful studies of Lithuanian historians, but also as a really important part of historical politics and contemporary cultural memory. According to the logic of the great historical narrative, the independence of Lithuania was lost disgracefully, even one shot being fired. But Lithuanian partisans redeemed that shame by their blood fighting with their war more than 10 years. And there have been numerous attempts to interpret the partisans' war in the history politics field and to suggest one statement that probably partisan war could be the core of new Lithuanian society's identity in the 21st century. It is difficult to say whether such project could be successful, but it is obvious that the memory about that period of our history became really important part of contemporary Lithuanian historical culture. And trying to summarize what was said, I must say that totalitarian paradigm was the answer which was chosen by Lithuanian historians during the first decade of independence, and that paradigm helped to interpret new and huge empirical material and gave some clear, and it is also very important part, some clear ideological and theoretic framework. That framework wasn't really sophisticated, but it was something really strong in emotional meaning, not so strong in intellectual meaning, but it was probably the first needful step for Lithuanian historiography, and I think that totalitarian paradigm isn't able to answer these questions which are important to the organizers of that conference. Because to a certain extent, I would like to evaluate that paradigm as a step which was already done, and to a certain extent we should evaluate these efforts as a history of Lithuanian historiography. Luckily, the situation in the academia was changed in the beginning of the 21st century, when Lithuanian historians started to work with the socio-cultural history of the Soviet period, and such changes permitted to appear the symptoms of some theoretic and methodological pluralism and in Lithuanian historians' academic discourse. And I try to group and to express the most important tasks for contemporary Lithuanian community. And in my opinion, the most important questions for us as a historians are 10 questions. First question, do Lithuanian historians have an opportunity to implant in the local context theoretic paradigms, background from global academic discourse? To what extent such implants can be lively? Second question, did such thing as Lithuanian specific during the Soviet epoch really exist? And to what extent such specific help us or impedes to use comparativistic perspective? Third question, what theoretic framework could be helpful for writing socio-cultural history of Soviet period? Fifth question, where is the place for such postmodern history topics and writing forms in the Soviet epoch field, such as microhistory or even counterfactual history? Sixth question, how Lithuanian historiography can use the tools from sociology, politology, and anthropology field, for example, networks, theory, interview method, and so on. Seventh questions: when and how historians should use not only archival material, but also other historical sources. Eighth questions, question how we should talk about Soviet epoch in the 21st century, where historians should fight for the audience attention with the journalists, filmmakers, writers, bloggers, and even with the politicians. Second question, following question, how we should evaluate whole Soviet-Lithuanian historic epoch as a gap of history or as a period where were some positive things? And the last question, what is the meaning of our Soviet history's experience? How we should evaluate that period? To what extent Soviet history help us to understand our post-Soviet reality? Trying to answer this question, Lithuanian historians made a few, in my opinion, important steps, which I also would like to briefly describe. First step, of course, it is a really subjective point of view. You have an opportunity to criticize that point of view and to say that to a certain extent I'm not right, but this is my personal point of view. So first, in my opinion, a really important step which was done. We have an opportunity to talk about the attempts to define the qualitative characteristic of late Soviet period Lithuanian society. In other words, to say something meaningful about society's life. And I'm talking about Violeta Davoliūtė, about Tomas Vaiseta. These authors already proposed some interesting and valuable ideas. Second step, interdisciplinary studies, where the group of authors, historians, anthropologists, politologists, and sociologists used network research method and constructed a model of the whole alternative society, which existed in the late Soviet period. And in my opinion, it is a really important new step trying to overcome that three-dimensional model of different forms of behavior which were already presented. So, third step, the efforts to analyze the strategies of behavior of Lithuanian intellectual and cultural elite groups during the different periods of Soviet epoch. And in my opinion, this is the place where historians work closely with representatives of other humanitarian disciplines, Kmita, Plumbys, Šukys, Ivanauskas. So we have quite an interesting group of young researchers. Another step, the attempts to recreate the development of different fields of cultural activity and art spheres, such as cinema, literature, photograph, and there is also the place where historians play only one of the possible roles in that field, and we try to listen each other, to create some possibilities for the dialogue. Another very important, in my opinion, step, research of thawing processes in Lithuanian social-cultural sphere, an important body of text covered the changes that took place in Lithuania in the 1950s that were analyzed by various authors from different aspects, Puzinavičius, Streikus, Kubilius, Primytė, Valiutytė. The sixth step, the research of Soviet-Lithuanian nomenclature groups, its interaction with Moscow, trying to create the version of our own national communism. And another step, the studies of Soviet propaganda mechanism. Another step, the attempts to analyze the Soviet epoch as the laboratory of different sites of memory and to interpret the Soviet epoch as a site of memory also, which exists in nowadays and interact with us. And the last thing, oral history experiments. Ninth step, oral history experiments, which give an opportunity to rethink Soviet experiment and its experience looking from one person's perspective. And I think it is really important because usually we play with large groups, we try to say some generalizations about this and that, but when we are trying to understand Soviet epoch, I strongly believe that it is really important to listen human being which survived that period, which still rethink that his or her experience, and to a certain extent that rethinking process creates some bridges, some possibilities for us to rethink also that Soviet experience. And last but not least thing which I would like to say, the investigation of different Soviet society groups which lived at the edge of legal, not legal. So trying to summarize what was said, I can state that the Lithuanian historiography in front of the Soviet epoch challenge found new topics, methodological tools, conceptual frameworks, and even new narrative strategies which help us better understand the history which is still near. But despite my optimism, I can't say that historians and their texts are the most important force which influence Lithuanian historical culture's form and content in nowadays. And that is why, going to the conclusions, I would like to say only a few words about the third part of my presentation, about different drivers of Lithuanian historical culture which influence our memories about Soviet epoch. And I strongly believe that other really important drivers of Lithuanian historical culture is the politics, media and art spheres. And I would like to leave aside the political animals and media world and to focus only on the art sphere. And of course, probably the most influential art form which interacts with the individual and collective memory is cinema. But Lithuanian cinema, in my point of view, did not produce yet really interesting, provoking and challenging in the gradations of Soviet history topics, despite its interest in that field, especially guerrilla warfare. Meanwhile, Lithuanian literature did a lot to play an important dialogue partner for historiography. And in that context, I would like to remind you only one novel, only one text, Marius Ivaškevičius' novel, The Green Tree, which raised a polemic storm, really polemic storm. First nowadays last polemic storm in the Lithuanian, such huge storm in the Lithuanian public sphere in 2002. That storm was provoked by a writer's decision to allow a Lithuanian society to perceive how General Jonas Žemaitis Vytautas, you all know that it is the leader of Lithuanian fight for freedom, and his gun brothers are seen by the other perspective, by the NKVD officer perspective, from Russian perspective, not from Russian, but from Soviet secret agency officer perspective. And as it has been mentioned, Žali caused one of the biggest scandals in the history of independent Lithuanian related to the reflection of her book. And in response to his criticism, the writer formulated several essential theses expressing his creative credo, and one of them states, the start of quotation, "Flags and loud slogans interest me considerably less than the people standing under those flags and colors." The end of the quotation. I think that such point of view is really important if we want to find the way how to live with the Soviet history and our memories about that, how to talk about our common experience. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Aurimas. We really don't have much time, but maybe if somebody has urgent question. If not, I would like to ask very, very short, maybe it's, you mentioned that generally Soviet period is not considered normal. So if I ask you to elaborate, it would take perhaps half an hour, or you can say again in your wonderful 5-10 points method.
Actually, we should remember one thing, that Lithuanian society is really traumatized because of different geopolitical force majeures, which we survived as a community during 20th century. And interval period is evaluated as a normal period of the sphere as a lost paradise. So according to that logic of great narrative about Lithuanian history, in comparison with interval period, Soviet period isn't normal. It is something unusual, something dramatically different, and that is why we still don't know how to deal with that. And even if we try to remember what was said during the Sąjūdis period, there were a lot of discussions how to come back to that lost paradise, how to live like our fathers and forefathers did during interval period. We should live like our grandfathers. I remember these statements from Sąjūdis founding fathers.
Yeah, thank you. We will have more time at the end of the presentations. So thank you again, Aurimas. And it is my pleasure to...